in our midst. Please turn tonight to the book of 2 Timothy chapter number 3. 2 Timothy chapter number 3. My cat friends are trying to get me started. You're not going to do it. There was a little poster up here, and I saw Pastor, he hit it quickly, because whenever I get started on cats, he has to do the cleanup for the next 2 weeks of all the people who are upset. So I'm not going to start. Neat little poster there. It said something like cats are short people covered in fur. But anyway, it was a nice little poster, and I appreciate all those little paraphernalia and memorabilia that I get from churches. And I get stuff from all over. You wouldn't believe some of the emails I get, some of the forwarded things I get. Last year, there was a weirdo in Denver, Colorado, and apparently he was a serial cat killer. Some of you might have heard about this. And maybe 2 years ago, some weird guy was mutilating cats in Denver, Colorado, and of course I wouldn't even believe in something like that, but he was killing them and stuff. So I got a call. I said, "Hello, Brother Rossi." "Yes, where are you?" I said, "I'm in Baltimore, Maryland." He said, "Just checking, because we're making sure you're not in Denver, Colorado. But count me out," that kind of stuff. And I would never do something like that. 2 Timothy chapter 3 tonight. 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse number 1. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1. All right, I'm not going to tell you what's black and brown and looks good on a cat. All right, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1. All right, I'll tell you, a Rottweiler. But anyway, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse number 1. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Verse 1, let's stand up together for the reading of the Word of God. Just comes out. You did it. See what you did? Stirring me up. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse number 1. "This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God." Look at verse 5. "Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away." Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. I want to speak tonight for a few minutes, and I want to preach an unusual message. Some of you may not get this message for several minutes, but I think it'll finally settle in before the meeting is through. I've been saved for more than 30 years now. God changed my life in September of 1976. I'll never forget the day when I had been saved longer than I had been lost. That was a wonderful day in my life. I don't know about you, I'd rather be saved longer than I've been lost. Amen? And that was a great turning point in my life. Some of you got saved when you were 5 and 6 years of age. Somebody said, "Well, I don't know about these childhood conversions. Jesus said, suffer the children to come unto me, for of such is the kingdom of heaven." Somebody say amen to that. And never, never downplay, never minimize salvation, no matter how small they are, no matter how young they are. Some of you got saved later on in life. Some of you got saved out of a life of sin. Others got saved simply because you were a kid and needed salvation, born in a Christian home, but you need to be saved with the same blood that saved that lost, vile sinner. Somebody say amen to that. Amen. Through the years, I've seen a number of forms of godliness. I was saved out of a form of godliness. I was born and raised in Roman Catholicism. And Roman Catholicism is a form of godliness, but it does not contain the power of God. There's ritual, There's routine. There is sacrament. There's ordinance. There's confession. But in most instances, in Catholicism, there's not a personal turning from sin and acceptance of the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross once and forever. I want to say tonight that Christ does not get sacrificed every week at the Mass. He does not die at the cross all over again. He tasted once death once for every man. Say amen. Amen. There are many forms of godliness. Some of the world's systems of religion put us to shame, to put it mildly. Those people who are involved in Islam have to turn three times a day toward Mecca. They have to turn three times a day and they face their holy temple and they have to pray and spend time in prayer wherever they are at least three times each day of their life. There are some systems of religion that are far more strenuous and demanding and taxing than what we call vital Christianity. Yet tonight, I don't want to preach about one of those forms of godliness. Instead, I want to preach about a form of godliness that I believe might be more dangerous and more subtle and even in some ways more damning than any other form of godliness that a man or a woman could embrace. I want to preach for a few moments tonight on the subject of a fundamental form of godliness. A fundamental form of godliness, what that means for each one of our lives. Let's pray together. Father, I pray for the power of God to rest upon thy word tonight. Lord, you know about many distractions of this day. You know about the hindrances of the evil one. God, we ask in the name of Jesus that you put a hedge around this service. I pray that every demon that's assigned to this meeting tonight, that you'd bind them, that you'd cast them out, and there'd be a sense of your working and loosing in our midst, and the power of God to be free to have your way among us tonight. Thank you for all that you're going to do. We give you the praise and the glory for all that will be accomplished, and for every soul that's saved, we'll be careful, very careful, to give you all the praise. Thank you, Father, for what you're doing. In Jesus' name, all of God's people said, amen. You may be seated. Thank you for standing for so long. Our text tonight was written by the Apostle Paul to his dearly beloved son in the faith, whose name was Timothy. In the last few chapters of the book of 2 Timothy, we find some of the last words that the Apostle Paul ever penned by inspiration of God. I preached a series in these chapters of the Bible when I pastored, and I called it The Last Words for the Last Days. These are some of the last things that Paul ever said before the day when they finally carried him out to be executed on a Roman chopping block and beheaded for his faith. It begins in chapter 3 and says, "This know also, in the last days perilous times shall come." He said it would be very dangerous. It would be very perilous. It would be a day and age when one's life would be in peril, literally, wherever you go. Understand tonight that I believe you and I are living in the most dangerous age the world has ever seen. Last year, I went to the Philippine Islands and taking a trip there, I had to renew my insurance policy just a few days before. And they said, "Mr. Rossi, we're sorry. You filled out on this form that you're going overseas to the Philippine Islands. We cannot insure you. You cannot have life insurance because of the fact that we do not insure people who go to the Philippines because of the danger of being kidnapped or hijacked or car bombed or worse. We live in a dangerous world." If you believe that, say amen. When I grew up as a kid in the city of Baltimore, right on the city line in Parkville, Maryland, I never had to worry about being stolen or abducted or somebody kidnapping me or carrying me away. We didn't have neighbors who had Rottweilers and Doberman Pinschers. We didn't have to worry about being beat up or shot or worse just because we looked at somebody the wrong way. It was a different world in which you and I grew up, those of us who are a little bit older in this room. Paul said that this know also, in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves. And then he begins to give a long list of the result of this devastating problem of self-love: covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, and on and on. And then look at this He said they would have a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. I've already mentioned tonight that there are many types of forms that you and I could have that would be considered a form of godliness. I mentioned that I was already involved as a kid in Roman Catholicism. I could talk about Catholicism. I could talk about liberalism. Some of the liberal people that I know, they go to church each week and they attend the Mass, or they go to the church and they have the Eucharist time and they take their communion and they say their prayers, and yet something is not there. Something is missing in their heart and in their life. And tonight I see a form of godliness that's far more deceptive and damaging even than some of these other forms of godliness, because I see tonight it is possible for you and I that believe the Bible and believe the Word of God to have a fundamental form of godliness. Did you know it is possible tonight to be a religious externalist? You can begin to live your Christian life based upon the fact that you don't smoke, you don't drink, you don't chew, and you don't go with the girls that do. I believe if we trust and believe the Bible, that you and I ought to have high standards. You believe that? Say amen. And yet Christianity is more than standards. It's more than an outward life. It is possible for you and I to have this form of godliness. The word form is an interesting word in your Bible. It means an appearance. It means an illusion. It means something that appears to be one thing, but in reality, it is another. The question is asked me many times, Brother Rossi, why do we lose so many of our kids? Why is it that so many of our kids that are forced to come to church and forced to come to Christian school and forced to memorize Bible verses? Some of you kids had to memorize Bibles verses just to eat when you were 3 or 4 years old. Amen. Some of you had parents that they had obey your parents' wallpaper there in the nursery room, in your room growing up. And understand tonight that there is of course, an enforced discipline when you're a child. Children, when they're little, they ought to be made to obey. Amen. They ought to be spanked. Amen. I've had people say, well, I never spanked my kids. And I say, yes, I can tell by talking to them. Amen. And your kids ought to be spanked. They ought to be disciplined. They ought to be developed and trained in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. I know some people, their kids are so strong-willed that they have a paddle on the wall that says, I need thee every hour. And constantly, they must discipline their kids. And yet sooner or later, they're going to have to make that transition where it's no longer mom and dad's faith,
that's right,
but it's my faith.
That's right.
Where it's no longer mom and dad's standards, but it's my standards. It's no longer an outward conformity to rules and regulations, but instead it's inward conformity to the righteousness and glory and person of Jesus Christ. An external life lives a life of show without substance, performance without purity, rules without righteousness, looks without love, conviction without compassion, and a life of duty without devotion. In Revelation 2:4, Jesus said to the church at Ephesus, I know thy works and thy labor, and how thou hast fainted, labored and hast not fainted, and on and on. They were a church that had it all together. They were working, they were laboring, they hated sin, they were exercising church discipline where necessary. But he said to them in Revelation 2:4, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast what? Left thy what? Thy first love. Next week we'll celebrate Valentine's Day, and I've already talked to my wife Susan about what we're going to do. Imagine this, ladies, your husband takes you out next Tuesday night, and you have or Wednesday night, have a little bit of time out together, and you go out to a restaurant together, and he sits down across the table from you and says, baby, I just want to tell you a few things. You're a great worker. I appreciate the way you wash and wax the car. You do a great job shoveling the walk whenever we have snow outside. I can't tell you that you're a great, how great of a cook you are. I appreciate the nice house that you keep. I want you to know, dear, that you are a real addition to my life. Also, I appreciate the fact that you bring in about $30,000 a year, and the fact that you work hard at the job, and you keep the kids ready, and you let me go hunting and fishing and all this whenever I want. And you are just really a great asset. I have you in the asset column of my life. You are an asset, baby. How many of you women would be thrilled with a testimony like that? Instead, you want him to look in your eyes and you want to say, sweetheart, I can't live without you. My pulse beats faster every time I see you. You look great. You're the most wonderful, gorgeous, godly thing I've ever... Hey, by the way, fellas, when your wife asks, how do I look? They don't want the truth. They don't want you to say, well, I'm not real sure about that. When your wife says, well, I feel so fat, they do not want you to agree. Do I have an amen to that? And understand, you're supposed to let them know how wonderful they are and how godly they are and how sweet they are. We had a little accident with the car today, and Susan and I talked, and I called her back a little bit later. She said, I'm so sorry, honey. I've messed the car up. I said, honey, as long as you're all right, as long as everything's fine, that's really all that matters. How many of you believe that's true? You know that's not true. Some of you men are going, are you crazy or what? She messed up your car. But understand something tonight. What's more important to women is not what a perfect house they keep and what a great asset they are. They want to know, I love you. They want something that sparkles and scintillates on their hands. Say amen. They like that little box of chocolate in the package. Say amen right there. They want to know that you love them, that you care about them, and that you've gone out and bought something special for them. Here, baby, I got something special for you. What is it? A new dishwasher. This will help you out. No, they don't want a new dishwasher. They don't want, hey, babe, I thought this would really help. I got you a new cordless drill for when you put stuff up in the house. No, they want something thoughtful and kind and sweet because they want to know that you love them and you care about them. The God we serve wants us to have a relationship. Do I have an amen? He doesn't want spiritual robots who simply serve him out of duty, although we ought to serve him because it's the right thing to do. God wants people who serve him because we love him with all of our heart, all of our soul, and with all of our mind. I want you to know tonight that it is possible for you and I to develop in our spiritual life a form of godliness without the power of God at work in our lives. Look at this, first of all, number one, I see in this chapter of the Bible the source of a fundamental form of godliness. He said, first of all, that perilous times shall come, for men shall be what? Lovers of what? Their own selves. That's where it all begins. I remember growing up in the 60s and early 70s, and Dr. Spock and all these psychologists began to give us all the reasons why the Vietnam generation and the hippie generation rebelled and why kids began to do their own thing. I remember when the Beatles came on and Ed Sullivan, how you remember those awful days, and then the Rolling Stones followed, and then Jimi Hendrix, and then on and on, and America began to suddenly spiral downward very, very fast. Psychologists began to come out with all the reasons why kids were rebelling and burning flags across America. They began to give us all the reasons why. And they said the real reason was most kids did not love themselves enough. I remember sitting across from a secular psychologist. I had gotten in trouble with the law, and that psychologist said, young man, you have a poor self-image, you have poor self-esteem, you have a low self-image, and we need to tell you that you must learn how to love yourself more. The psychologist suggested that I look in the mirror every day, and 8 or 9, 10 times a day, I was supposed to look in the mirror and say, I love you, I love you, I love you, and that would help me out. How many of you would say that's not encouraging? Say amen right there. I look in the mirror and get depressed. And some of you should too. Say amen. He said, Brother Rossi, I'm good looking. That's debatable as well. Amen. And so, folks, I had no source of life. I had no ability to find peace. I had no ability to find joy and happiness because I was trying to find it in myself. The problem is tonight, most of us don't have too low of a self-esteem. The problem is most of us love ourselves too much. And your real issue, and the worst problem you have, and the biggest challenge you face, is the one who you look at in the mirror every day, and the one whose ladies, whose hair you curl, and men, the one whose face you shave. The Bible said in Ephesians 5:29, no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourisheth it and cherisheth it. You love yourself. You love yourself so much that if I were to come down from here tonight and take a bat and start swinging around, you'd hold your arms up. You'd protect yourselves. No one would say, I hate myself so much, Brother Rossi. Please hit me in the head with a bat. Nobody would do that. You would protect your body. You would protect yourselves because we all love ourselves. Somebody said a man wrapped up in himself makes a very small package. Amen? And some people are so much into themselves that every moment of every day, they can't wait to talk about themselves. Let's talk about you. Oh, thank you. I've been waiting all day for this. Amen? They want to talk about themselves. And the source of a fundamental form of godliness is a self-centered life. A life that is motivated by self-love. A life that is motivated by self-glory. A life that is motivated by what I can get and by what I can gain. A self-centered life is carnal. A Christ-centered life is crucified. A self-centered life is fleshly. A Christ-centered life is fruitful. A self-centered life is prideful. A Christ-centered life is pliable in the hand of God. A self-centered life is holy or hollow. A Christ-centered life is holy. A self-centered life is concerned with reputation. I'm saying, oh, what do people think about me? What do church members think about me? Some people are so self-centered when they come into church, they're sure that everyone is talking about them. When they huddled up in the football game Sunday night, they said, are they talking about me in there? They're sure everybody is talking about them. A self-centered life is we're concerned about reputation, but a Christ-centered life is concerned about righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. Understand tonight, Jesus said in John 12:24, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. Young people, you know why you get your feelings hurt so much? Because you're living a self-centered life. You know why moms and dads, you get so mad and upset? Because you are living a self-centered life. And you have a form of godliness. Hey, right in the middle of your argument, somebody calls. I'll tell you right now, hi, Pastor, how are you? And you can turn it on and off, but God knows what we're really like. Somebody say amen to that. And a self-centered life is a life of striving and contention and pride and envy. You know why you get mad when other people get blessed and you don't? Because you're living a self-centered life. You know why you're so negative about everything? I mean, people that are so negative, what a beautiful day. It'll get worse, I assure you, amen? I mean, all they can think about is all the trouble that's coming around the corner. Praise the Lord, what a blessing. Open up a birthday card, I have $25. Better not spend that, you'll be broke tomorrow. And they're always worried and always fearful because they're all worried about themselves. Have you ever noticed that a dead person can never fight back? Have you ever noticed that? You can walk up to a corpse tomorrow, and I've been around a lot of them. I've been around people that died. I've been at the bedside of people who passed away. I've been at many funeral homes for visiting. I've preached many funerals. I'm sure Pastor has more than I have. And I've never had one time a dead person look up at me and say, hey, it's too hot in here. Turn it down. I'm steaming hot. Never had a corpse look up and say, oh, Brother Rossi, I'm freezing cold. Turn the heat up. Never had one. Never had a corpse say, hey, preacher, you're preaching too long. Shut down the meeting. Never one time say amen right there. My brother passed away, and he's the funniest guy. And I'll never forget walking by his corpse, and he had this little smirk that they put right on the corner of his mouth. And he always had that little smirk. He's my brother that called me Lou Baby. I think I preached about him before. And he was a tough guy, an Italian, and he started shaving when he was about 5 years old. You know, one of those kind of guys. I mean, rough and tumble. And I walked by, and everybody was saying how good he looked and all that. And he had that little smirk. They put it right there, just right. It was the little smirk that he always had. And I thought, boy, I wonder if he could say something. If I'm laying in a casket, would you not walk by me and say, Brother Rossi looks better than he ever did? Please don't say that about me. But I won't get offended. I won't get mad. I won't get angry. I won't rise up and say, hey, you know I look terrible. Don't lie about me there. Hey, I would never do that. You know why? I'm dead. Dead people don't get offended. You can tell them they're ugly. You can agree with them. I mean, when a woman says, I look terrible today, and you go, oh yeah, I see. They won't get mad. Say amen right there. They're not saying, I look terrible. They're fishing for a compliment. How many of you know what I'm talking about? How many of you men have learned this by a hard trial? Say amen right there. And I'm saying tonight, we all... Did you say amen, Pastor? Brother Jones? Brother, Yeah, there's an unseen hand, all right, brother. And I'm saying tonight, we've all learned things the hard way. The truth of the matter is, you know what the problem is in America? We've got too many people sitting in pews that are full of self instead of Christ. That are full of their own way and their own agenda instead of the presence and the glory and the Spirit of God. Why didn't they let me sing in the church? I already told you Sunday, amen. Because you can't sing. Somebody say amen. And understand tonight, it is time for some of us to see the source of a fundamental form of godliness. Secondly, I see in the Bible the symptoms of a fundamental form of godliness. They're listed right here. I'll not preach about them all. Covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy. Can I just point out one of those problems? Can I point out one of those symptoms of a fundamental form of godliness? What about the symptom of ingratitude? We live in the most ungrateful society I believe the world has ever produced. It's not necessarily our fault. We've been given everything and just handed everything. Young people sitting here tonight, they've been given just about everything young people could ever want. We're having pizza. What kind? We're going out to eat burgers. Where? When I grew up, brother, if they said burgers, we just said pizza. Burgers. Where? We go walk in and just inhale the pizza. And if you look at youth groups when they're in middle school, junior high, you have pizza night. They come out. The pizza's put out on the tables, and it's gone in 3 seconds. By the time they hit senior high, they look at it and walk over and rub up against it a few times, make a few cat-like noises, and decide whether or not they want to eat it. Amen? And I'm saying to you tonight, it is time to realize the more we get, the less grateful we are. The more we get, the more we think we deserve. And we're unthankful. We're ungrateful as a society. You and I ought to be grateful for the fact that we've been washed in the blood of Christ. We ought to be grateful for the fact that no matter where we've been in our Christian life, I sat on this chair, and as the choir was singing, I thought, man, that unseen hand has certainly been at work in my life. I can look back and watch the goodness of God. I sat there and asked the Lord to forgive me today for murmuring about the car being hit and murmuring about the problem that's going to cause. And I sat there and I said, Lord, thank you today that even though the car was messed up, there's always an unseen hand. And if I look to you, there's some good reason and some good that can come out of it. My son had to remind me, hey dad, it'll be okay, it's just the devil. And I said, thank you John, go in the other room. And I didn't want to hear that. I didn't want to hear about the victory. And that's how we're all wrapped up tonight. Understand, by the grace of God, you and I as God's people must realize how unthankful we really are. A dear lady came to my office. I was pastoring in Atlanta, and she was a young woman. She had two beautiful daughters. She had a lot going on. I mean, a good things in her life. She was involved in our school and on our staff, had a good job. Her husband had a good job with a big corporation. And she came walking in one day, as she did every day, trudging in, walking in with the weight of the world on her shoulders, bent over more than I am with my ribs. And I mean, just bent over every day. And as she came walking in, she said, Pastor, could I talk to you for just a moment? She was one of those people that you never asked how she was doing, because she'd go into a lifelong dissertation of how hard it's been. How many of you know what I'm talking about? And some people, you don't ask how they're doing. How are you? It all began when I was 3. And so she was one of those types. And I remember talking to this dear lady. She said, could I see you for a few minutes today? I said, fine. She came in and sat down. She said, Pastor, I'm struggling. I said, ma'am, here's what I want you to do. I don't even want to talk to you today. I want you to get a vanilla sheet, get a legal sheet, a pad of paper, and I want you between now and Sunday morning, it was Thursday morning, I want you to write down 50 things that you're grateful to God for. She said, oh, Pastor, I really can't think of any. I said, all right, let me take a few minutes and I'll show you how to get saved. She said, wait a minute. She said, I'm saved. I said, no, you can't be. You just told me you don't have anything that you're grateful to God for. And she said, well, wait a minute. Well, I guess I'm grateful for that. I said, why don't you start right there? If you're saved, put that at the top. Hey, how many think we ought to be grateful for the fact of salvation through the precious blood of Christ? I said, then go over to the business office and our administrator there will give you some money and you can go out and get a little meal up the street. I'm sure you hadn't eaten in several days. She said, we ate this morning. I said, I thought you didn't have anything you were grateful to God for. You mean you ate and most of the world didn't and you don't have anything to thank God for? She said, oh, I didn't think of that. I said, all right. Apparently your kids are both in the hospital. They're really messed up. What happened? Nothing. They're fine. There's something to thank God for. Somebody say amen. I said, all right, we'll get the heat and the electric turned back on in your house. Apparently they've been cut off the last few days and you don't have heat, you don't have electricity. Oh, we have heat and electricity. I said, I thought you don't have anything to be grateful to God for. Then I didn't yell at her like that. But anyway, counseling with Brother Rossi. Hey, get out of my office. How many believe I didn't have a lot of counseling when I was a pastor? And I said, understand. You're missing it. I said, we'll send Pinkertons and the FBI out to get your husband. I know where he is. I said, you do? I thought you didn't have anything to be grateful for. You got a husband. You're saved. You got food in your stomach. You got food in the refrigerator. You got a house. You got two beautiful girls. You got some good things going on. You're employed and half of Atlanta, Georgia isn't. Hey, it's time for you to get out of your little sob street and move out onto Thanksgiving Boulevard and Hallelujah Square and start thanking God for His goodness in your life. That Sunday morning, I was sitting on the platform. And I, most pastors sit really sort of back behind. This is where they sit so they can view the entire congregation, figure out who's not there. When pastor's writing down, he's writing your name down. They weren't in church today. They were late today. They were asleep today. It's a long volume by the time the service is over. Amen. And I'd sit there and write out all my little stuff. And I was sitting there, and we stood up, had a congregational. She came in about 5 minutes late, which was her habit, always 5 minutes late, no matter what. And she came in through the back of the auditorium and trudging in, but she was different today. I noticed all the way to the back of the auditorium, there was something different about her countenance. There was something different about her hair. I mean, her hair even looked like she looked like she was 80 years old. She was only a young woman, and she came in. Her hair was different. I noticed she was fixed up a little bit. She was kind of spruced up a little bit, walking, had a little spring in her step. Her daughters actually looked happy for a change and came walking in the back of the auditorium, saw her talking to one of the ushers and smiling, came right up during the singing time and sat right on the front row. I was on the platform. She looked at me, had her little list, and said, Pastor, Pastor. I said, I'm on the platform. Lady, settle down. I said, talk to my wife. She's down there. And during greeting time, she ran up, Pastor, I've got my list. I said, okay, I'll see you after church. And after church service, she came up. She had over 100 things. She said, God is changing my life. God is changing my heart. God is changing my whole outlook because I'm grateful to God. You know what happened? She quit thinking about herself and started thinking about how good God is. And you know what happened? She moved from having a form of godliness to the power of God begin to work in her life through a spirit of gratefulness and godliness and all that it took. And God began to work in her life. Covetous, boasters, proud. I mean, are we proud or what? Some people are so proud, they're waiting for everybody else to have revival, just sure that they don't need it. Proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents. Young people, I'm not even going to mention that tonight. There are kids in this room that you know you're in disobedient to your parents. Even though mom and dad and you would never admit it, you're not dressing the way they want you to dress. You don't act the way they want you to act. You're not talking to them the right way. You're disobedient. You're disrespectful. You got a little pooch lip every time they say no. And you say, what's their problem? And you get all mad at them. Hey, it's time for you to realize this whole world is not revolving around you, Junior. Say amen right there. And poor little Bubba, poor little Bertha, they're all upset about everything in life. Everybody else is doing it. All the other kids get to go. Mom and dad don't believe that stuff. Say amen. All the other kids get to go. Maybe not. Why don't I get to go to Paris? Why don't I get to see the Eiffel Tower? Because you don't deserve to go. Say amen. You haven't worked long enough and you haven't lived long enough to go see the Eiffel Tower. Therefore, you don't deserve to go. Somebody say amen. And yet we got a generation of kids who think they deserve a break today and all that goes along with it. Disobedient to parents. traitors, petty. Verse number 4. Traitors, heady. Look at this word, high-minded. Some people are so high-minded. The church ought to just revolve around me. After all, I'm sharp. I'm talented. I can sing. I'm pretty. Maybe. And I've got all the tools for success. And I've got a Coke bottle figure. It'll be a 2-liter one of these days. And I've got all that goes along with it. And I've got everything that everybody ought to have. And so you're just so wonderful, high-minded. Who ever heard of the church revolving around anybody? Say amen. The church ought to revolve around one person, and that's Jesus Christ, the Son of God. It ought to revolve around the fact that He suffered and bled for our sins and went down into the grave, and 3 days later came up out of that grave with resurrection power coming off His body. You and I, as God's people, we ought to be Christ-centered and glorify Him and let no flesh glory in His presence. High-minded. You say, I ought to be teaching. I ought to be preaching. Actually, I think your pastor ought to be preaching. The pastor is God's appointed man. I think I ought to run this church. And a man that had the idea that he knew how to run the church better than anyone else. And finally, one day, I called him into my office. I had the keys sitting on the desk. I said, sir, it's time for you to fly this plane. What? It's time for you to take the wheel. He said, what do you mean? I said, you've been thinking long enough that you can pastor the church better than anybody else. I think I'm just going to take off for a while and let you do it. Amen? He said, I couldn't pastor the church. I said, then quit making all your nasty little suggestions every time people see you out in the hallway of how it ought to be done and why are we doing this and why are we doing that. Why don't you start learning how to follow godly leadership instead of having such a high mind? Do I have an amen? It gets quiet in churches when you preach like this. But it's time America realizes who we really are. You know what you are the best day of your life? You're a sinner, saved by grace. You're an old lump that God took out from the miry clay. And He set your feet upon a rock. And He's established your goings and put a new song in your mouth. And the very best state that you'll ever reach, the Bible says, is altogether vanity. That's the best you can muster up. That's the best I can muster up, is vanity that's been washed in the blood. And thank God tonight, we ought to live a life, instead of living a form of godliness, we ought to live a life, a form of godliness. We ought to live our lives with the power of godliness. High-minded. Lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. I don't like a church that's got 3 services a week. I don't like a church where the pastor wants us to go soul winning and serving. I don't like this church where we have to go out when it's cold and go knocking on doors. And where it's cold, we have to run bus routes. I think I'm going to go up to this church where they tell me it's only Sunday morning and then the rest of the week we can have fun. They've got a golf club. They've got a fellowship club. They've got a bowling league. They've got softball in the spring. They've got basketball in the fall. They've got all the cool stuff to do. Hey, folks, we ought to get out of this mindset that the Christian life is a playground. It's not a playground. It's a battlefield. Somebody say amen. And it's time we get out of this mindset that a church is a place where we can come as consumers, look on the menu, and take what we choose. This is the house of God. That bulletin is not a menu. Say amen right there. And you say, well, Brother Rossi, I'm going to go to a church where it's easier. So we've developed consumer ministries around America. Welcome to the river. Welcome to the vine. Welcome to the tomato. Welcome to the grape. I don't know about you, when I get up in the morning, I don't want to go to a cucumber, amen. I want to go to the house of God, to a local church, visible New Testament. And it takes commitment to have a local church. It takes commitment to get people saved. It takes commitment to run bus routes. It takes commitment to serve the Lord. And tonight, with the grace of God, we ought to love God more than we love pleasure. Somebody say amen. I don't think men that are 50 years old ought to be on a ski slope. Say amen. I'm going to start preaching against it now. Say amen and amen. Lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. Having a form of godliness. There are the symptoms of a fundamental form of godliness. There is the source of a fundamental form of godliness. And I see in this chapter and others like it the sadness of a fundamental form of godliness. You know what's so sad? A man or a woman that lives with a fundamental form of godliness lives a passionless life. No passion, no joy. The only things that get them excited are the hobbies that they have on the side. I see people half asleep in the house of God, yawning, looking at their watch, waiting for the service to get over. You mention, yeah, I like old Fords or old Chryslers. They immediately stick their head up. It's as if they've had their head down in a hole somewhere. Zoom. Hey, did you say old cars? Hey, come on, brother, keep preaching. And now they're fired up. I see women that look bored to tears. They can't stand it anymore. They're looking at their nails and women get so nervous looking when they don't want to be in church and go looking into their purse. And who knows what in the world's in a purse? Amen? I wouldn't even look in there. And they're in their purse and they're doing this and they're looking all around. But you say, the shopping mall. Zing! Did somebody say mall? Amen. Do you say tanning salon? And they're back. And I don't care what your passion is, but when we touch on it, you see people suddenly come to life. I preach in churches and watch men deader than the 4 o'clock hour. Mention, I've got a real nice bow at home and I like to hunt. Did you say hunting? And immediately their mind is back in gear. You know what our passion ought to be? Our passion should be in Philippians 3:10, that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His suffering being made conformable unto His death. Our passion ought to be Jesus Christ Himself. Our passion ought to be the glory of God. I remember a young man I ran into a few weeks ago, and he said, Brother Rossi, I remember when I met you years ago. You were in a revival meeting. He said, Brother Rossi, what is your hobbies? I said, preaching. He said, what do you do in your spare time? Preaching. He said, what do you do when, you know, you don't have anything else to do? What do you like to do the most? Preaching. This is my hobby. Say amen. Going to church, the house of God. I can tell you, we take a break on occasion, and we go out in the woods once in a while and pretend to be some kind of a hunter, and after a few days of freezing out there and pretending to be a woodsman, I'm through with that stuff. It's time to go back to church. Say amen. I'd rather have the Lord. I'd rather have God's presence. I don't know about you, but David said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Preaching, serving, soul winning, winning people to Christ. That's what this is all about. Say amen. And Paul said, I'm addicted to the ministry of the saints. And so this is a passionless life. This is secondly, if you study your Bible, this is a life that's not only passionless, this is a life that is indeed pretentious. It's a life that has to always be worried about someone finding out what we're really like. I don't know about you, I don't want to live a life looking over my shoulder. Do I have an amen to that? One thing in church, another thing at home. One thing at the house of God, another thing down in our own house. And I got to the place years ago where I just got tired of playing church. I get nervous around people who pretend as if they never sin. I get nervous around people who never can smile. You never smile, I'm worried about you. I had a man in my church who never smiled, and man, you wouldn't believe the crazy stuff that guy was involved in. They never smile, never enjoy themselves, always, bless God, I don't like it. You know, they think preachers ought to just get up with a mean spirit and open their mouth and preach for an hour and a half and be meaner than the devil and just lay everybody out. Hey, folks, why don't you just let God have His way? Say amen. Never smile. Never enjoy the Lord. Never enjoy their family. Pretend like they're reading the Bible all the time, all day long, and praying all day long. I get nervous around people like that. Mash their finger. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Amen. I mash my finger. That's not what I say. Oh! I scream when I mash my finger. Amen. And I'm saying tonight, it is time for some of us to realize God doesn't want us to be perfect. God wants us to be real. He wants us to be broken. He wants us to be honest and humble enough to realize where we have needs, and humble enough to realize where we need the grace of God, and humble enough to realize how good God really is. I remember preaching in the church that I pastored, and I preached from Matthew chapter 23 about the Pharisees and who they were. And I preached about how that they had long prayers and they had a pretentious life and how they pretended to be one thing in public and they were something altogether in their private life. And I began to make the application. I said, folks, can you believe in the 60s and early 70s there were churches around America that had big signs in the auditorium, no women allowed with pants on in our auditorium, and that we had actually bought throwaway skirts and made girls put skirts on to come to church, not realizing the whole time that the church I pastored was one of those. I had several men meet me after service. They said, did you know we had those signs in our church? Did you know that we had those skirts in our ladies' rooms? Did you know we wouldn't let young women, the young hippie girls of the 60s, come to church until they first changed the way they looked on the outside? Jesus said, come unto me, all you that are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I don't know about you, friends. I'll take a whole church full of hippies as long as they're getting saved. Say amen. And of course we're going to see their life change. Of course we're going to teach them how to dress right. Of course we're going to teach them how to walk with God and serve the Lord. But I'd just soon have a bunch of old dopers coming to church and some of these long-faced, narrow-minded hypocrites who've been in church all their life and think they know more than God himself. Somebody say amen. Amen. A pretentious life. A pretense life. A passionless life. Thirdly, this is a purposeless life. I'm talking about a life with no purpose, a pointless life, a life with no desire, a life with no drive, no zeal, just simply going through the motions. I believe a fundamental form to live that way is a prayerless life, a person who does not pray. You say, Brother Rossi, I say my prayers every day. You say that 3 or 4 minute prayer. I call that a Brill Cream prayer. How do you remember Brill Cream? Remember the old phrase? A little what? A little dab will do. And some people have a Brill Cream prayer life. They put on just enough so that it doesn't affect them. Just enough so that they can actually say, I prayed today. I sought the Lord today. But my question is tonight, when you pray and seek God, do you pray as long as God wants you to pray? And do you pray through for the great needs of those around you and pray for the power of God upon those who need to be saved around your sphere of life? Understand tonight, this is a sad life, powerless, pharisaical, pointless life. And finally tonight, there is a solution to a fundamental form of godliness. Are you still with me? Good. Should I just quit or should I finish the message? Good. All right. Thank you, all three of you. Anyway, the solution to a fundamental form of godliness. I told you, you'll have to help me. You'll have to help me tomorrow night, too. I'm not preaching the way I want to, but I believe God's going to use this anyway. A solution to it. There is a solution. You don't have to live your life with a form of godliness, denying the power thereof. You don't have to live your life as a religious externalist and hoping that someday it'll all make sense. You can live your life with the joy and the peace and the long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, meekness, and faith that are all a part of the fruit of the Holy Spirit that God wants to bloom and birth and develop in each one of our lives. I want to give you a few thoughts before we go home tonight. Number one, you and I should recognize this form as it develops in our lives. I'm talking about the fact we ought to recognize those areas that are not real, those areas of our life that are not holy, those areas of our life that are self-centered instead of Christ-centered, those areas of our lives where we have to be bribed and coaxed instead of automatically want to serve God with our life. Young people, if Christianity is simply the next prize and the next event and the next game for you and the next exciting activity, you are living a life of pleasures more than loving God. You ought to come to church because you want to come to church. Somebody say amen. You ought to come to the house of God because you have a burden and a passion to come and be a part of what God is doing in your life. Recognize this fundamental form of godliness. Number two, we should repent of it. We should get to the place where we say, God, I don't want to live a barren, fruitless, hypocritical life. I want you to have your way in all that I am. Number three, remove yourself from this form of godliness. As a matter of fact, God said, from such, turn away. You know people in church that are complainers? You shouldn't hang around them. You know people in the church that are always soured up about something and questioning things? You shouldn't even be around them. Do I have an amen to that? Young people, you have friends that are always griping about the leadership and griping about the administration and griping about the teachers. You shouldn't even hang around them. Remove yourself. You ought to be around people that are on fire and live around people that are stirred up and be around people that love God and want to serve Him and want to have a burden for souls. And there's that removal from that which keeps you from serving God. And finally tonight, there's the principle of replacement. Where you can get to the place where you're truly dead to self and alive unto God. Or you could say with Paul, it's no longer I who liveth, but Christ who liveth in me. Or you can say in Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. I started not long ago in my life to begin to do something every day before I ever leave the home. In my prayer and devotional time, I practice this now every day. I did this morning. I said, God, I don't know what today's going to bring. I don't know what all's going to transpire. I didn't know that my wife was going to hit a pole while I was talking to her on the phone. We were talking, I heard this. I said, what is that? I just hit a pole. I didn't know that was going to happen. And there honestly is a time in my life where I'd have gotten very angry. I would have said something unkind. I wouldn't have been the husband that God wanted me to be. But I prayed this prayer this morning before I ever talked to her, before I ever talked to my son, before I ever talked to pastor. I prayed a prayer that went something like this. God, I don't know what today is going to bring, but I choose to die to self. I choose to live unto God. I choose to glorify You no matter what it is. And Lord, I don't know what phone calls are going to come. I don't know what trials are going to transpire. I don't know what good or bad things are going to occur. The last week of my life, it's been incredible. It's been one trial after another. And yet, honestly, I've never been less ruffled by trials than I have over the last week. Because every day I've been saying, Lord, I choose to be dead to self. Lord, I choose to be alive unto You. Truthfully, I might have had a coma in that accident, didn't even know it. I might have had a concussion, and I'm still half knocked out. Because I'm telling you, I'm just not as bothered by things as I used to be. I ought to fall down on ski slopes more often. Say amen to that. My wife will send me up there every year. But I'm saying, folks, understand, you and I can live in the gut. You don't have to lose it every time your kids don't do the way you think they should do. You don't have to get mad when your dog chews up the furniture. You don't have to get mad when your cat, never mind. You don't have to get angry. You don't have to get bitter. You don't have to get angry when your husband doesn't treat you in the way Christ loved the church, which He should treat you that way. Man, you don't have to get angry when your wife does not submit to you in the same manner as the church is in submission to Christ. And ladies, you should treat your husband that way. Thank you, all three of you. And you and I should not get angry when our kids don't obey their parents in the Lord, for this is right. And young people, you ought to obey your parents in the Lord. And you and I don't have to act bitter and angry and harsh and mean and blow it in private and then pretend to be something different in public and continue to exercise and live with this fundamental form of godliness. And folks, now every day I say, Lord, I die to self. I choose to live to God. And Lord, as I live for You, would You use me to be a blessing to somebody else? Would You use me to witness and let people know that Christ died for their sins? God, would You use me to be a servant and live in such a fashion that we no longer have agendas But now we live our lives solely for the purposes and the goodness and for the glory of God. Can you live that way tonight? Let's bow our heads, please, and our hearts together for prayer.